Welcome, everybody. I'm Silje from one of the organizers of Beyond the Gates. We're so happy. Thank you. We are so happy to finally pull off this festival after these years, and we are so happy to see all of you coming into Bergen. And we really hope that you will enjoy those days. And we are also very happy to have Mr. Nergal here. I think you should give him a big hand. Also doing me in that man show yesterday, which was super great. I hope you saw it. And also Frank Godla from Metal Injection, the founder and director. Very happy to have him here. So I leave the microphone to you.
We are here today to discuss Nergal's career and the amazing journey that he's been on to get to be the one of the most recognizable extreme artists in heavy metal history. Nergal, welcome to the heavy metal classroom.
Thank you for being for sticking around and for being here and for taking your time, precious time, for spending this embarrassing moments with me.
speaking in classrooms, I figure we start there. I wanted to know, growing up in Poland, what was, your upbringing? Were you into music through school, or did you get through it through a different avenue?
I got into music in the early 80s. I was born in 77, so I was born under the sign of the two sides. I like that. It's very black metal. And mid 80s, I was already into music, just any music, really. So if you saw me, like this little kid, just getting attracted by pretty much anyone. So when I saw Kiss on Polish TV, national TV, which was quite a common thing to see, or Maiden, George Michael would be next, and I'd be like blown away equally, okay? So it's first coming out today. So pretty much any music from behind the Iron Curtain would be very engaging. Anything, it really, really felt like a forbidden fruit to me. That there's like this whole world that is just so different from this dull, black and white, communist entourage that I was surrounded with, and those guitars or whatever. It could be pop music, could be heavy, anything. I would just get it, and I had this tape recorder, cassette, and the way we would get music, we would keep music. These days you don't need to keep music, you just have this device and you just share it, right? Back in the days, I would like to own a cassette, and then two cassettes, and then five cassettes, and then this would grow into a pretty decent collection of cassettes. But they were not originals, because there were no originals back then in Poland. Only pirate tapes, or you just sit with your cassette recorder, and they would play "Wasted Years" by Maiden on national TV. And we just and recorded, like no cable, nothing. So imagine how shitty the quality would be. The quality was much worse than first Behemoth recordings. Seriously, crap all the way through. But it would just lead that spark, and I would just continue doing that. And I remember my brother who's 8 years older, he would just kind of introduce me to a lot of those bands. He would just bring stuff, and just play Deep Purple, Perfect Stranger. I just had probably the first boner in my life at the age of, I don't know what. Now you're not really allowed talking about stuff like that, so please don't share that information, because I don't want to be accused again of something that I'm not. But I was very young, and I was having erection regularly when listening Western, let's call it Western music, popular music.
That said, we are here in Bergen, Norway, an important capital and hub of the early days of the Norwegian black metal scene. What was your first recollection of the scene here?
I'm going to go with an anecdote, all right?
Yeah, please.
So yesterday, there's this gentleman. We did a show with me and that man downstairs, I believe, at 1 a.m., which was way too late for... I'm 45. I was already like falling off. But we did that. We pulled it off. Who saw it? Who saw the show? What the fuck? Nice. Was it good? Was it good? I loved it. I went beyond my abilities, honestly. I was like so on fire and it was amazing. And of course, you know, we wanted to keep that adrenaline going after the show. So we used a lot of things, you know, to keep that going. And then I saw this guy that's just storming into the backstage room and I'm like, holy shit, I know that face. I know that face. I'm Abbott's son. And that was Immortal's Abbott's son. Sorry, I don't remember the name. You help me out here if you know him. Abbott's son. What's his name? Torbjörn. Oh, that's beautiful. Torbjörn, of course. So descendant of the Vikings, right? I see this face, and guess what? I see this face, and like holy shit, he looks like a little bit like Abbott, and a little bit before he introduced himself, and a little bit like Demonas. And then I connected dots that Abbott fucked Demona's sister, and that's probably the most immortal thing you can ever fucking get. Amazing. So, we party. He's super fun. He's like, I always need to think, you know, if I should say something because then I regret. And I'm like, okay, we party. And then like farewell and we split ways and he goes like, yeah, you mean so much to me and, you know, Evangelion and Satanists and what you do, blah, blah, all that stuff, you know, which is very nice and I appreciate that. But then like, I'm telling him, but hey, you know what? See, there is a cycle. You're coming here to me after show, sharing that valuable information that I'm gonna take to the grave, and that is very important, and I embrace that. But it's your father who lit that spark in early 90s, and I remember getting like the first immortal, you know, not it was actually official license of fucking hell, first record was a Diabolical Full Moon Mysticism. See, 45, and. So I remember getting that and just trying to get into that music. And I was, what, like 15, 16 back then and just listening to it on my Walkman. Do you know what's that? Walkman, cassettes. And just getting into that and getting that Nordic fire and just being so inspired that I was like, holy shit, I want to not replicate, but I want to do something like that on my own ground. In Poland, you know, with people that were not very much interested in doing that, you know. So I was the one, and then I met Bal, my neighbor and my friend, and the former Behemoth drummer. And we would just share this passion for Norwegian, Swedish, but mainly Norwegian early black metal wave. So Immortal, Burzum, Mayhem, and the list goes on, and that is fucking amazing, you know. So that's how it started, getting those tapes, doing tape trading. So some of you guys, I see like a lot of great people, you know, like me, so you know what tape trading was. Some of you probably don't know. We just send out cassettes, you know, and like I remember sending a cassette to, I don't know, like Mexico or Norway or whatever, you know. And that's how I became pen pals with Dimmu Borgir. I remember there was this guy, it was called Skogen magazine in Switzerland. And he was this, Sasha was his name. And he was really, he had a lot of contacts in the Norwegian scene. And he would send me a list of, now listen to that, I have the list of like all the important figures in Norwegian scene, phones, personal phones, not cell phones because they were not invented back then, or if they were that big. So there was just a stationary phone. So guess what I did? Of course, I would just give it a shot and fucking, you know, call Ulve. So yeah, and some other people, and we kind of, you know, build a friendship. It's a, I mean, we are friends now, nowadays. Back then, I was just pain in the ass from Poland at the age of 17, maybe. But I was so, I really looked up to those people. So yeah, very important, and it's still here. And I'm very sentimental about that. And I also make that point a lot these days, because there's a lot of, I mean, it looks like there's a black metal renaissance going on around. And honestly, I know there's a lot of quality out there, but that's maybe just me. Maybe you are different, you know. But when I get on Spotify and the algorithm suggests you, oh, listen to this, listen to that. And I go and I fucking listen to this and to that. And nothing fucking stays. It just goes here, out. And I don't want to offend anyone, but there's like literally like very few bands that are just that are memorable, you know. And there's hundreds and hundreds of bands out there that put a lot of energy, and they're amazing, you know, like great musicians. Everything sounds beautiful, and all those covers, and everyone is being so artsy, but nothing fucking stays here. So either I'm dead to that new thing, new black metal thing, and or I don't know. I mean, where's songs? You know. So when you put Immortal, Mayhem, even Blasphemy, it was all about songs, verse, chorus, AC/DC formula. Where is that? It's no more. So I'm just not getting that modern stuff. Like most of it, I'm not getting. Yesterday, I managed to catch a few songs from Gals Wirth, and I was actually very touched, and that was really moving. First, I really liked the records, and I saw it live, and it was like, holy shit, that's serious. Mm-hmm. That's very meaningful. Okay, yeah. So I have it with me. And there's a few other bands that are, I'm thinking, are sticking out, are standing out among this wave of, again, my opinion, mediocrity. So this is Bolzer, this is Deathspell Omega, and a few more bands that just do something different, you know. But back then, again, back to Norwegian fields, every band, and there were numerous, and all of them were fucking so influential. Every band would sound completely different from another. Look how much individualism was here. That, like, you take the whole black metal modern scene, and where is that? Where's personality? Where's charisma? You know what I mean? So again, it's gonna be my tribute to my dear friend Ulve, who's a modern, who's an incarnation, a black metal incarnation of Lemmy, of course. But he's a fucking character. He's charismatic, memorable, absolutely like lovable person. And then you go to Emperors and Burzums and like plenty of other bands, Mysticum. Each one of these bands was like a separate planet. Mm-hmm. They were not even, you know, like separate planets. And everyone was amazing. And some of them, most of them, sounded like shit, but I didn't care. I would just be so immersed with fucking Anthems to the Walking at Dusk. I mean, can you get any note there? Because I still can't. But I'm still in love with that magma that was just mesmerizing, and it was just took my heart and forever. And for that, I'm thankful to the Norwegian, particularly, but Swedish as whole, because there's Dissections and modern bands. I mean, it's not modern, but Vetain is one of those bands that kind of carry the torch. And there's, of course, a few more. I don't want to miss anyone out, you know, because I don't want to get punched out in the street later. But I guess you know what I mean. So by this, maybe a little too long elaborate here, I just expressed how much it means to me to be playing here in Bergen when it's started. And just being surrounded with all those friends, you know, just bumping into each other in the streets, you know, that is amazing. You know, that's why I think Beyond the Gates is one of those festivals, very intimate, very personal. You know, there's no stardom here, you know, because there's no way. I mean, like, you go out in your flip-flops, you know, to have breakfast, you know, and this these two dudes are asking me for an autograph, and we're gonna do that. So I fled, but you can't get away. You're always at people's faces, you know, and so there is no barrier. It's super friendly. So I love it, and I would really love to play here with Behemoth at some point again.
Fuck yeah, I love all of that. Everybody, give it up for the festival and Bergen, Norway. But Behemoth had, you know, morphed and really switched gears, going from maybe more conventional black metal back in the day to the black and death metal stars that you are today. What happened? And can you tell us about like where that shift came from? And were you ever afraid to alienate the fans that you had established in the first maybe 10 years of your career?
What you see with Behemoth is, again, anecdotes, because I love those. And from the time prospect, they seem to be very funny, too, because I remember getting a death threats back in the days for changing my style and for putting a wrong image on the cover. And I mean it. I had fucking people invading my room with a gunshot. Indeed, it did happen in the 90s when I supposedly... it was a sacrilege for some, probably NSBM or whatever people, not friends of mine, that thought that, oh, you shouldn't be doing this, you know, we're going to execute you. No, well, they didn't. I'm still around and I'm still paying the ass. But things like that did happen, you know, because I was evolving, okay? When I started Behemoth, I was literally 15, 16, okay? So I see 15-year-old or 16-year-old, and I'm like, holy shit, it's a baby. It's a walking fucking toddler with his laptop and his video game. And I was already writing lyrics about something that I wasn't aware of. I was so naive and so inexperienced, you know, but I was kind of aiming for something that was out of my wisdom prospect, so to say, or like abilities, you know. I wasn't there. I was like 16, 17. What do you know when you're 17? You're just a piece of shit and you know nothing, basically, you know. So maybe it's better to focus on video games. But I was focused on fucking exploring heathen past or Satanism or occult, you know. Why? Probably because it was unknown, and I've always been attracted to the unknown. So what is behind that wall is what gives me again this, okay? This is fine, but this is safe. I'm interested in what's behind that. So when I finally learned this triton, they call it, levels in musica, okay, what's next? Oh, this, oh shit, cool. Then I think I can bring my music to the next level. And then I got a drummer by the name Inferno, who's still my longest husband in the band. We've been together for 25 years. So I've already survived his two marriages and we're still together. And and his abilities to play like way technical, it would just give me a platform to evolve as a musician. So I was like, holy shit, you know, fuck that primitive stuff, you know. I can do way more with the drummer who can just be all over the place. These days, of course, it's very easy. You just go on YouTube and every drummer beats the shit out of him when it comes to technique. And that is a fact. There's a lot of YouTube musicians out there that appreciate their skills and stuff. But it's not about skills. It's about this. It's about soul. And it's about just making a statement by who you are. So I decided to evolve, just getting more technical. Why? Because I could. Plus, I was not only a fan of Burzum, and still am, mark my words, but I also was into death metal and Morbid Angel and like Deicide and all those bands. And I'm still a massive fan of both and fucking plenty of others. So I was just like, okay, how can I can expand those spectrums? So those black metal or death metal spectrums, you know, we go this, we go that, you know. So if we can't go any further or faster, we'll go sideways. And that's what I think Behemoth has done for the last few records, you know, because when I listen to Apostasy these days or Evangelion, me and Inferno, we see like, man, it's not doable anymore. I can't do it. And he's like, I can't play that fast. So what do? We go sideways. How can we express ourselves sonically and be real in that, be genuine, but not just, you know, overdoing ourselves. Let's just do something else, something different, go back, go left, right, you know, jump, whatever, but make it exciting and make this journey, this artistic journey, exciting. So, started as a primitive death black metal band, then more very Nordic inspired, then a lot of Slavic influences, and then just moving towards more death metal-ish landscapes. And a lot of, like these days, you know, we are all very eclectic about what we do in lives, right? That's like when I'm looking at you now. So most of you are bald. That's why I keep my head. But that's not the point. The point was like in 90s, metalheads, black metalers, it was an army. They all looked alike. They looked like fucking, you know. So you didn't want to fuck with those people, you know, because they were very, very serious. These days, the crowd, metal crowd, is like this, you know. I, you know, there's a guy at the terminal just approaches me, is like, and he looks like, I don't know, a salesman, you know, like with a suit and everything. Oh, I'm such a Behemoth fan. And I'm like, how are you? And then he just names songs and stuff. I'm like, holy shit, nice to meet you. So that is amazing. But this is today, very eclectic. So today, when band like... there's this a Death Heaven, okay? They release a Pink cover. I mean, in 90s, these guys would be dead by now. Obviously. But, you know, these days you can get away with stuff like that, you know? I fucking got away with fucking a Polish version of Britney Spears, you know? And no one fucking killed me for that. But in 90s, that wasn't a standard. So... I would just get a lot of accusations for being just for not sticking to the canon, okay? Just for being trendy. Oh, he's trending. He's just looking, you know, for his ways to maybe get more attention and stuff, you know. But no, my nature has always been very much all over the place, and I'm still the same guy, you know. Just like that's why I do a lot of experiments, not only with business, but like music too. I mean, black death metal band covering David Bowie, Nine Inch Nails, Killing Joke, Polish punk bands. I don't think there's many, you know, that have, I mean, how many times you can fucking cover Slayer and Venom? With all due respect, you know, I love those bands, but it's just fucking boring. Plus, the originals, they're always the best, so fuck that. If you are in this genre or subgenre, have balls to go into this and challenge that. You can fail. I think our Bowie cover is it's far from good, to be frank with you. But I did that, and I would never fucking turn it back, because sometimes when I step into that other space and I try myself out there, I'm like, okay, I'm shit there, or I'm the shit. So, and then I might take a bit of that, bring it back to Behemoth, and just move it sideways again, because we can't go any faster, right? So I can enrich my own music, my own band. So I'm gonna wrap it up now. So back in the days, all those guys, let's call them the true black metalers and the elitists, they would run all those lists of enemies of black metal. I always wanted to be number one, so at least once I was. So they accused me of changing styles. But then at the same time, all those guys were the biggest Bathory worshippers. This should make you think. It always made me think. I'm like, what's wrong with me? Why they're not after Quarthon? Every record was fucking, what the fuck, you know, Vikings,
right.
Goats, fucking airplanes, Luftwaffe. No one had problems with that. No one. Why? Because that was sacred to them, right? So maybe I'm building something with what I've done throughout 30 years of my musical journey, with something that is going to be sacred, but not, but it's not going to be stiff. It's not going to be rigid. It's going to be relatively flexible and approachable too. You know what I mean? It's like, that's, I come across people who say, well, I don't really like black metal, but I really dig you guys. And that is a huge fucking compliment to me.
Right.
Compliment to me is when I see black metal elitists these days coming to me like, and they're like bullying me or whatever, and they fucking hate Behemoth. That means that I did something right. And I see this guy convert to Behemoth, maybe time to go. So I see that I have my signs, you know, that I know, I think I'm on the right path, you know. I usually use my balls and intuition to stay aware, you know, like, oh, I think this is the right course. Let's go there. Oh, let's go there, you know. So all these things. So, yeah, that's why Behemoth is so versatile. It's so up and down. It's so all over the place. Yet, still, it's quite, quite on its course, you know. It's, we never went too far, you know what I mean? It's like, I remember yesterday when we were performing with me and that man, and that is quite a, another pole to what I do in my mother band. So I do this, what I call it necro blues, but it again, it's all over the place. And we even have a shanty song. And that's what I said yesterday. That, again, I'm getting away with singing a shanty and not being fucking shot in the middle of the death black metal festival. That is sign of times, signum temporis. But, and I'm going to say it at forum so you remember, and please take it with you. If one day you'll see me doing a reggae song, please kill me.
Well, I think fortune favors the bold, and I really commend you on you know, your experiments, as you've mentioned, and really bringing Behemoth and really your career through so many different avenues. Because a lot of bands out there within, you know, they don't get what they want after the first 10 years, the first 5 years, and they throw in the towel. You know, it's just not quick enough. It's not, the gratification isn't there. Did you ever, I mean, you've had a long career, over 30 years now. At any point, did those thoughts ever cross your mind?
Yeah, probably every day. To some extent, yes. I mean, I have my, you know, down moments every now and then. And I have lots of doubts. We're on the verge of splitting up on many occasions, but we never made a drama of it. Or when it did happen, there was no social media, so we were not aware. And that is another problem. As much as I love it, I hate it. It's a lot of double-edged swords that you have in your hands these days. And if you want, we can later maybe elaborate on that. And I just want to alert people that there's stuff that you should be very mindful about, you know, what we're, you know, all these devices and all these new tendencies, you know, in our lives, we should be very, gentle with that, okay? But anyways, again, anecdote. I was giving an interview a few days ago, and it was Amir, I believe, to Guitar World or something like that, and he asked me, what advice would I give to music, like a youngster, a black metal music, he want to start a band, and what advice, what he should do to guys, and I don't mean it. You can laugh, but don't mean it as a joke. Don't do it. Fucking don't start another black metal band. Don't do it. Go on Spotify. There's millions of bands with logos that you can never fucking read, with names that you can never fucking remember. Plus, Immortal, it's already been done. Burzum, done. Mayhem, done. Behemoth, done. And so on. Don't do it. And then I found justification to this arguable comment, because some of you, maybe some of you want to start a black metal band, and I'll fucking do it, you know. I'm not preaching here, I'm just sharing my opinion. But then around the same time, I'd be watching something on YouTube, and then I see Cliff Burton from Megadeth, right? They're not paying attention.
Yeah, I know, right?
I caught you. Cliff Burton, interview, 84 or something. And, hey, what's your advice for other metal bands? And he's like, fucking don't do it. Just quit. Like, there's only this many Fridays and Saturdays, Sundays, and Metallica wanna play. There's only this amount of clubs. Don't fucking do it. And I'm like, kindred spirit. That's it. I exactly mean that. So I'd say this, because that is, I think, a clue here. When I was 15, 16, 17, I not only it was my passion, it felt like, and it almost will sound like almost a sectarian or maybe a religious, which in my mouth may sound weird, but I still feel like it's a mission, okay? So I'm kind of a missionary. Just, I sing about it in my songs, you know. I use a lot of metaphors. You're probably never going to get through them and just find that out, you know. But when I sing about the torch of Heraclitus in Of Fire and the Void, I exactly mean that. So it's not just some, I fucking steal a lot of stuff from ancient civilizations and cultures. But I only do it to express the fact that I want to be that guy who carries along that musical tradition and some wisdom, if I have any. I might be completely dumb, but maybe not, you know. So I have this genuine need and to do it, okay? Just you gotta kill me to stop me. So if you have that, and if you know, no, I can bring something new to the table, I can change something, I can, well, Galsverdi is not a new band because the guy is already a legend, you know, but this is a new band, and I'm like, there's some flavors that I haven't seen anywhere else, okay? It's still tradition, but it's some flavors. I'm like, okay, this is something something else. Oh, this is the right descriptions. You know, it's like when you listen to some band, okay, they're a black metal, they're death metal, but they are something else. They're just something that sticks out, and like, holy shit, that's gonna make me remember these bands in 10, 20, 30 years. So, yeah. What was the question?
If you ever thought about giving up originally.
Yeah, okay. So, yeah, giving up. So that's why. Missionary and just, no. This is it. This is me. This is my lifestyle. This is who I am. My every cell is screaming those words. Is playing those notes, and it's literally in my DNA. I'm even bored with myself when I grab guitar and I would just punch it and like people, yeah, it sounds Behemoth. Oh, really? Of course, because it's my fucking DNA. It's automatic. It's like it's your muscles. It's automatic memory, you know, of your muscles and your body, you know, that you do certain stuff, like, you know what I mean? So when I play guitar, when I do stuff, you know, you may, at some point, you'll be like, oh, we've seen that, we've heard that. Well, yeah, you know, but that's me. If you see Tony Iommi fucking spitting another classic riff, you know, do you want to hear Yngwie Malmsteen? No. No. You want to see and hear Tony Iommi. So I'd say, if you want to start a band, black metal band, any band, aim to be Tony Iommi. Aim to be a bath. Aim to be a character. Aim to be somebody. Wasp. So, I don't know. It may sound to you like maybe, I don't know, like, there's like the very modern nomenclature that I get like under my posts on Instagram, often edgy. I do something edgy. Can someone fucking explain to me what that means? Okay, I don't give a fuck, you know? Okay, maybe I'm edgy. And maybe what I'm saying is edgy. But you know what? It's honest as fuck.
I like that you actually brought that up because I did want to talk about, you know, your ways of using social media, particularly. You're an early adopter of Instagram. It has painted you in a very different light, I think, you know, the way the fans look at you, approach you, and it tears down some walls of mystique that were in metal for the longest time, especially in black metal. But what it's really done is it's polarized the way people really think of it, and a lot of you know, labels and whatnot are now thinking about how it's advantageous to use stuff like social media for musicians. And it's really essentially made you kind of the poster boy of Instagram and metal music. Do you feel as though your online presence created a change or a shift in you and the attention that your band receives?
Maybe. I don't know if I want to go and start the band and like, and the value of the band equals what, likes or followers? What's that? You know what I mean?
Right.
My Instagram is quite popular, you know, but then again, it's 420K followers there. It's shitload of people. And I never thought when I started the crap, I was like, yeah, let's play with it, you know? So I used it for many reasons. Professional, but then I just started expanding that. And I'm like, I'm really bored with, not that I was pretending, but like the younger you are, you just, you know, pretending, okay? You're just putting all those masks and stuff, you know? And I observed, you know, like the older I am, the less compromises I'm willing to take to live through the day, okay? So if something's wrong or if I feel like this or like that, you know, I'm like, I'm just that. I'm good enough being, I don't know, hangover these days and whatever. I'm good enough, you know what I mean? I'm good enough the way I look. I'm good enough being who I am and so on and so on. So it's really very personal. So when you see me excited on Instagram, I am fucking excited on Instagram. When you see me beaten and fucking tired, I'm not pretending I'm that. I am that. And there is no manager. There is no, you know, I don't know what.
Outside influence.
Yeah, no. None of that. That's why I get into troubles, because there's no voice of a reason. There, that someone's like, maybe you shouldn't putting that online. I do, and there's this beautiful saying, like, it's better to do and say sorry than, you know, ask for permission. And I love that, honestly. And again, you know, I don't regret anything that I did on social media. Plus, it's only just a little piece, like a fucking 1% of my life, really. So I get that too, you know, from some haters and people who have doubts, you know, like,
right.
You should focus on music. I'm like, seriously, you need more? I'm playing 3 p.m. with me and that man at Wacken, 7:30, same day with Behemoth, and you're telling me that I should focus on music? Seriously, running 2 bands, fucking touring the globe, just doing all that stuff around. You need, should I start another band or? No, that is my nature. I'm all over the place. I'm ADHD probably, not diagnosed, but maybe. I'm hyperactive. That's me. I'm like, I'm this. That's why I do that. You know what I mean? So. Yeah, some days I'll be more intense, you know, with, you know, putting stuff out, you know. Other days I'm like, I do that social media detoxes as well, you know. And like, I ask many people that I know, like, could you ever just fucking switch it off for a week or two? And like, there's no person that I know that I met that said, yeah, sure, I can do it.
Right.
No. Oh, one day maybe. But there's work, there's family, there's kids, there's dog. Dog is good. I'm like, okay, see? I'm very active. Yeah? I public a lot of stuff. But then I fuck off to fucking Dominican Republic or wherever the sun is. And far from Polish miserable weather. And I just shut down. And guess what? It takes me one day to forget that this exists. And then it's just whatever. So that is amazing. So I can do those, shifts. I can just swap from one to another. But then, if I do those detoxes, I'm very, very fucking curious what's going on.
Right.
And guess what?
Nothing.
Nothing. Nothing.
Yeah.
Every day is exactly the same. There's same fucking drama. It's like with, I made this metaphor once, probably sitting on a beach in Dominican Republic and thinking of a river. And I imagine myself on the shore of a river and I'm sitting there and there's water. So imagine this is live, social media, and I'm sitting there and I'm doing this. Oh, cold. Mm-hmm. Okay. And you take your legs out. But the river never stops. The stream goes on forever. It will never stop. It will take different curves. It will just go a little up, tied down. But it will never stop. So this is life. So again, another coming out. I'm a FOMO victim as well. Dopamine. I get that, Probably, I'm guessing most of you have that. And since I realized that, it's been a few years now, I'm kind of trying to figure out how to limit that and how to start retracting from being a victim to those amazing devices, okay? I'm a fan of it, but then I'm anti-fan. I'm very, polarized here, okay? So how to stay sane in this world, that are offering us so much? Because there's definitely too much. Mm-hmm. It's too many stimulants. I don't need that. So why I'm still fucking there? I don't need that. It's like with food. I'll go to the restaurant later today with my boys. Not my boyfriends. I mean the band members. Every day I see that. We go to the buffet and they take their plate like this big. Inferno. Fucking, he always takes this much. And he eats only a bit of it. And he goes like, first of all, he wasted so much food. That's inferno. But then it's Orion. He's going to take that much and he's going to eat it all. That's why he's a big guy. I'll take this. I need this in my stomach. I need this in my stomach. And I need this to go on for another 2-3 hours. And then I'm going to have another snack. So see how smart I am? I'm very smart with my eating habits. I'm very particular about that. Very smart. And I know what I'm doing. So why the fuck I'm not doing the same with my other platforms, with my social media? I should do the same, right? I don't do that. I don't use the same habit, the same discipline in other platforms. So this one should inspire me to be more moderate in other dimensions. I should do that at some point, and I will do that. So what I'm doing now, I'm retracting from Facebook. Slowly. Why? Because it's fucking old. It's boring. And I realized that, I don't know, lately, let's say a year or 2 years ago, when I was banned again. Banned. And back in the days, it was 3 days. Then a week. And then, when we are about to release I Loved You at Your Darkest, 2 weeks before, they would ban me for a month. So, you can imagine what it means that I cannot you know, do all the social media work before and right after the record. When the record is out, it's like, you know, they put me in cuffs. It's just, I can't do it. Shit. And I was pissed off. Nowadays, when they ban me and they do it fucking every 2 weeks for another month, I'm like sitting there like laughing because I'm not using it anymore. Almost never. What I do, I just click on Instagram, post on Facebook. So I don't even need to go on Facebook and read those comments that are completely meaningless. It means nothing. It's just people's fucking opinions. Bullshit. So retracting from Facebook, and I want to get to the point that I won't even be checking that. So I deleted the app from my phone. It's not there. So it's one penny less, okay? So when you're taking shit, you know, it's only Instagram now, which is good. So maybe Instagram is the next thing to limit that. I don't need that. I don't need that. I'm just saying that to share you with my concerns about that. Maybe it's outside of me, but it's also connected with music as well, you know. But
of course.
I just, yeah, I'm concerned about that, honestly. And but why are you limiting my abilities to promote my music? Because then you ban me for a month and I cannot post about new song, new album, whatever. But no one thinks about it. Why? Because algorithm has a little mustache here and you're gonna have no dialogue with it. No dialogue because there's no human being out there. And that is a big problem.
I didn't want to interrupt you, but we have 5 minutes and three questions left. I know, right? So we'll try to get through these briefly, but in your own opinion...
Can we continue tomorrow?
Oh, yeah. In your own opinion, what is the biggest reason or change that took, you know, a young Polish black and death metal band, Behemoth, to a worldwide audience?
Oh, you tell me. One. Two more.
Catchy tunes.
I like that.
Original.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh. I scratched the word originality from my dictionary forever. And I hate that. I curse that word. I hate that. So instead of originality, I use another term. Unique. Uniqueness. So Galsvirt, again, I saw it. It's not original because it's kind of the same, but it's unique. And with all the modesty, I think that Behemoth is absolutely not original, but it's unique. So I'd say uniqueness. And but that's maybe just the wording, okay? But I like that. Hard work, absolutely. And you said catchy. But then again, man, fucking Powerwolf is also catchy tunes, man.
I would say Bravery.
Huh?
Bravery. I think you guys are brave, and especially you, like the way that you speak your mind and you're comfortable in your own skin. That's something that you don't really see with a lot of artists out there.
And I think this is a beautiful conclusion that also sums up the nature of Polish nation. You know why? Because we're known for doing things that are completely... I mean, geopolitically, we are fucked, okay, as a country. I mean, just look at the map and you know everything. But then again, this country, this nation, like this Polish people, for what they are, and they're just another average country of average people that didn't really bring much to the world's culture. A little bit, but nothing spectacular. They can be, and that is the word I think, very belligerent. And I think that you said bravery, but bravery is where belligerent is like when you're just brave, but you don't think about it. And I think most of my times I've been fucking belligerent. I would just storm into the room and I'm like, holy shit, Rob Halford is there, you know? And I would just storm back and I'm like, what the fuck you're doing? Just go ahead and act as you fucking known the guy forever. And that's what I did. I don't know if it was smart, but that's me. You know what I mean? Oh, you can't enter this room. Really? Look at that. And I do that, okay? Oh, you won't jump. Seriously? I jump and I break my leg, but I will jump. That is not smart. Please don't do it on your own. But that is my Polish nature. So 2 days ago, we had this anniversary of Polish uprising. If you don't know about that, then I mean, I advise you to read, because that is a beautiful story. But it's 20,000 soldiers died, 44, Warsaw. There was an order by Germans to destroy the city completely. 200,000 civilians dead. Stupid. Fucking stupid. But still, they were so pissed off. They had nothing to fight with. They would just fucking throw this at the tanks. Not smart. But they still do it, okay? So that is Poland. A lot of uprisings. There's only one or two uprisings in Poland that were successful. All of them failures. Look at the fucking wars. We failed mostly. But again, we keep on fucking doing that. So maybe there's this DNA, like the thing in the DNA that I'll just do it regardless. While other people, like Czech, Prague, right? They'll be like, oh, Germans, hey. And you go to Prague and you see it's fucking stunning beauty, right? Architecture, beautiful. Why? Germans, come and go. But they kept that. Paris, same story. Fucking beautiful. Warsaw? Not so much. But I'm still in love with Warsaw. I still love the fact that I'm that. I carry it with pride, regardless. Although most of that is not very smart. And I'm thankful for that, because that brought me to the place I am now. And I'm not only talking with Behemoth worldwide, whatever, because that's all kind of surreal now, because we're here in Bergen, which is small, gorgeous town full of amazing people. And this gave me the chance and platform to talk to you, my friend, and to see you listening to me for 1 hour blabbering. And you didn't even stop me. So thank you so much for that. It was a pleasure, all right?
Thank you, guys.
And I would honestly go on for at least 1 or 2 hours. And but maybe...
Maybe next year when you come back with Behemoth. Or
that is a great idea. But do I?
I don't know. I'm not the person to ask.
Torgrim, do you know something about that? Okay. Talk to my agent, please. So yeah, I would love to do that. You know, maybe that gives me a... I think there's already a lot of, you know, content that maybe I should just continue with doing another part of my book. Mm-hmm. Maybe, but I prefer talking than, you know, writing. You know, I'm just too lazy. I like talking. I like confronting people, so... And this is also stage, you know. I don't need to scream, you know, so but I can talk at least and just maybe, yeah. It's more mellow, but I love it. So sharing those energies is amazing.
Right. Well, Nergal, I commend you on your belligerence, your, you know, comfort in your own skin, and keep it going after 30 fucking years. Everybody, give it up for Nergal.
That's a plan. Thank you.
And pick up the new Behemoth.